Live, local, breaking news. This is WYFF News 4 at 6 in high definition.
Her mother loves her. I love her. God loves her.
Father breaks down in a bond hearing for his daughter, who's charged in a fatal hit and run.
And family and friends say their final goodbyes to two more victims of the Boston Marathon bombings as authorities continue the investigation. Good evening. Glad you're here. I'm Michael Cogdill.
And I'm Carol Goldsmith. We begin with that fatal hit and run case and new information about the suspect.
News 4's Mike McCormick has more from our Spartanburg newsroom tonight. And Mike, the solicitor says this is an unusual case, right?
Yeah, that's right, Michael and Carol, and that's because the suspect and the victim actually knew each other. The solicitor says the women were together the night before the accident, but he wouldn't elaborate about that. This afternoon, families on both sides had to face each other as the suspect faced a judge for the first time.
You understand the charge and the penalties?
Yes.
The charge, hit and run involving death. The penalties, not more than 25 years and up to $25,000 in fines. It all stems from a hit-and-run accident that happened around 4 a.m. Monday at Lake Forest and Torino Drives in Spartanburg County. The solicitor told a judge that Colleen Casey was overheard on a 911 call saying she shouldn't have been drinking and driving and that she should have been paying more attention to the road.
She did have a smell of alcoholic beverage on her at the time.
According to the solicitor, Casey was involved in drug use. The victim, Jacqueline White, later died at the hospital. According to the solicitor, she was thrown some 40 feet from the impact. In this hearing, her brother spoke out against Casey.
She is a danger to this community.
Casey's dad spoke in her defense.
Colleen's a good girl.
He says he's the one who found her, and then she volunteered to surrender.
Her mother loves her. I love her. God loves her.
The judge called Casey a danger to the community and denied bond. Casey's dad called out to her as she left the hearing.
I love you, Colleen. You know that.
Sit down, sir.
And today at that hearing, the solicitor said more charges could be coming in this case. Mike McCormick, WYFF News 4, live tonight in the Spartanburg newsroom.
All right, Mike, thank you for that. A tragedy has forced a popular Simpsonville restaurant, the Coach House, to close temporarily. One of the owners, John Mastrocolius, was killed last night in a crash along Woodruff Road. It happened just before the entrance to the Stonehaven subdivision in Greenville County. News 4's Angela Rodriguez joins us live and local. She is in Simpsonville tonight. And Angela, there is one word you keep hearing over and over again from the friends and the customers, right?
Giving, Michael. That's the word we keep hearing over and over again to describe John, even from the competitor next door. And we've seen it firsthand tonight. Loyal customers are wiping away tears as they leave behind flowers. It's rare to see this parking lot empty, but it's a time for grieving. A growing collection of flowers marks the passing of one of the founders of the Coach House, a popular Simpsonville restaurant that opened its doors on Main Street more than 20 years ago. Troopers say 59-year-old John Mastrocolius somehow lost control of his car along Woodruff Road last night and slammed into a tree. A makeshift memorial is now honoring the life of a man who devoted his life to serving others.
It is just like a family, and like I said, Johnny was really responsible for all that. You would come into the restaurant and you would see him. He would sit down with a couple, and you weren't sure if they were his friends from previous or he just met them today and they were just meeting him for the first time, and that's just how he was.
His generosity even helped win over the competition next door.
Like I said before, John was a very good man and a good friend, good for the community. May he rest in peace. Our hearts go out to their family.
And John's son tells us that he wants his father always remembered as charitable. As for the restaurant, the sign on the front door says it will remain closed until Saturday as this family continues to grieve. Angela Rodriguez, WYFF News 4 tonight, live in Simpsonville.
Angela, thank you. Cherokee County deputies say they have arrested and charged a man in connection with the shooting at a gas station. Brian Lamar McGill was taken into custody this morning and charged with attempted murder. Deputies say McGill got into an argument with another man at the Aunt Em's Kangaroo Express gas station. That's on Shelby Highway in Gaffney at about 9:30 last night. That's when deputies believe McGill shot the other man in the head and then left the scene. At last check, that man, who was identified by family as John Quentin Rawlinson, was listed in critical condition at Spartanburg Regional Medical Center. Anyone with information about this shooting is asked to call the Cherokee County Sheriff's Office at 864-489-4722. We have breaking news this afternoon. In the ricin-tainted letter sent to President Obama and a U.S. senator from Mississippi, charges have now been dropped against the suspect. The suspect in the case was released from jail. Authorities have not provided any information about why Paul Kevin Curtis was released. Yesterday, FBI agents admitted in a hearing that no ricin was found at his Corinth, Mississippi home. Meanwhile, a second Mississippi man says the FBI is searching his home in connection with the case. Everett Duchka says he has nothing to do with the case, and he doesn't know anything about the ingredients for ricin.
Well, now to the latest in the Boston Marathon tragedy. Hospital officials now say the surviving suspect in the bombings is doing better, in fair condition now. That's an upgrade. And he is said to be cooperating now with authorities from his hospital bed, writing answers to questions and nodding his head. Our report tonight from NBC's Jay Gray.
There is activity again along Boylston Street today. Residents and business owners allowed back inside the blast site, others returning to pick up items left in the rush after the attack.
The first day was, a little on edge, the adrenaline running, but after that, you just begin to just really kind of think about what could have happened and just kind of move on from there.
The investigation is also moving forward. These newly released pictures from an ATM machine show Jahar Tsarnaev during a crime spree the night before he was captured. From his hospital bed, authorities say he's indicated that his older brother, Tamerlan, was the mastermind behind the attack and that the two acted alone, motivated by a desire to protect Islam. The wife of the slain suspect is cooperating with police, but her attorney says that neither Katie Russell nor her family in Rhode Island has any inside information about the bombing.
The reports of involvement by her husband and brother-in-law came as an absolute shock to them all.
The shock and pain of the attack continues to wear on so many here. The youngest victim, 8-year-old Martin Richard, was buried in a private service today. Friends and family also gathered to say goodbye to MIT police officer Sean Collier, whose brother says he died following his lifelong dream.
Ever since a very young age, this is what he's wanted to do, and he did it. I mean, he worked his tail off, and he really has made us all very proud of him.
Pride and determination in a city that during some of its most difficult moments continues to stand strong.
Tomorrow, more than 10,000 are expected to join Vice President Biden on the campus of MIT for a memorial to honor Officer Collier and other victims of the attack. Jay Gray, NBC News, Boston.
And the love continues to flow north from here. Tonight, a run is going on, in fact, right now in Greenville, to help the victims of the Boston Marathon bombings. Check it out. Fleet Feet organized this 2.62-mile run walk. We understand it is a huge crowd at Furman University. Overwhelming response, so much so the event had to be moved from the Augusta Road area to Furman. It all got started at 6 with a moment of silence. Most of the runners or walkers are wearing blue or yellow, the colors of the Boston Marathon. This is a free event, but donations are being collected for the OneFundBoston.org fund.
Tomorrow, the Spartanburg Public Safety Department will host its 15th annual Day of Prayer for Crime Victims. The annual gathering is a part of Victim Rights Week and lets members of the community come together and recognize those who have suffered in violent crimes. This year, the event will be held at noon in the front parking lot of Spartanburg City Hall. Again, this is tomorrow. The theme will be new challenges, new solutions. Lunch will be served afterwards.